Okay. I want to code a Game Boy emulator, and I want to do it in WebAssembly. I think the best language to use for this would be Rust, and I want to try to use the pixels crate. So I think I'm just gonna start by copying their example. By the way, does the audio work? Let's quickly check that. No, it does not. Actually, nothing works. Now you should at least see the stream. But why does the audio not work? The audio works. Okay, all good. Now let's copy that. Maybe make it a bit louder. Nice. I've got a project file already set up. But there's really nothing in there, just the default main file. And right, let's just see if the example even works. Might honestly not. Why is my GitHub theme changing? Weird. Let's copy all the dependencies. What I'm installing on the left side here is just a simple web server so I can see the files we are generating. Game Boy. The all file, let's just remove that for now, we don't need it. Edition should be 2021. Publish false. Yes, I think that should obviously be version 0.8, that's the most recent one. And I think that's it, honestly. Now, what can I stop alt tabbing into here? Now, what do I need to run? Oh, so I need to wait for this to finish compiling then? All right, it's web server. It will take a while to compile, actually. Now let's take a look at the code we just copied. Actually, I'm fine with clippy warnings and I don't mind some unsafe code. We've got the log crate, okay. The width is already wrong because according to the Game Boy technical data, it's one, no, it, this is the one. 160 by 144 pixels. So that's what our image should, our canvas should look like. What was it? 160 by 144. 160 by 144. Yes, I think that should be correct. Now, what is the box size? I think that's just from the example. We don't actually need that. That's for setting up the logger. It's all just setup stuff. All right, all right. So basically, the entire game state is handled by this world struct, which I guess we should replace with an emulator. Game Boy. Nice. Let's not modify around too much for now, because I do want to see if this even works in the first place, because if it doesn't, I have to figure out something else. Let RGBA equals if inside the box that else that. Oh, it has support for alpha values. I mean, I guess we don't really need that, but it is kind of nice. I did think about using U for WebAssembly, because with Wasm bindgen we kind of have to interface between JavaScript and Rust, which is a pain, and U just basically replaces JavaScript with Rust. It supports JavaScript interoperability, that's like the opposite of what I just said. But it's way easier to use than Wasm bindgen, but I can't find any examples using it, and I don't want to spend like 5 hours figuring it out myself. So I'm just gonna use Wasm bindgen. I mean, it works as well. It's just a bit more work. If this could finish compiling, that would be kind of nice. Let's see how this works. We have an update function and a draw function. And the draw function just for iPixel and chunks exact match. What does chunks exact mut mean? Why do we get chunks from that? So the update function is just basic physics stuff, like a really basic physics engine. So I guess the box should just fall down onto the ground and stop. I don't know. World.update, window.requestRedraw. Oh, so we can actually generate window events from within the window event loop. That's neat. World.draw, pixels.getFrame. If pixels.render. Oh, so we kind of like have a buffer. We kind of generate a buffer with the world.draw function, and then we render that in here. I guess that works. And if we fail to render whatever, we just exit. Cool. Now I know that the input buffer, that the frame buffer from the Game Boy is actually larger than the frame itself, because the frame buffer I think is like 32, I don't know, but it's larger. So you can store more than what's actually shown on the screen, and I wonder if the Pixels crate actually has just native support for that. Like, don't draw the entire buffer, just draw it at that offset. Using a windowing framework or context manager, blip blip blip. That does not matter. The backend does not matter. Represents a 2D buffer. So that's what we call dot render on, right? Render texture format. Clamp pixel positions. Clamp a pixel position to the pixel buffer texture size. This can be used to clamp the error value returned by window post to pixel to a position clamped within the drawing area. That we don't need that. Q, what's that? Just some internal drawing stuff. Cool. Cool. I guess we don't actually need most of this, because the Game Boy does it itself, but it's a cool feature, I guess. failed to compile WASM Bind and CLI. Some crates failed to install. That's what we love to see. But just did install. So we can run the command, which I forgot because I'm competent. Just serve minimal web. Just serve. I guess it's just serve Game Boy because. Nope. No just file found. So we need a just file. What's a just file? Just dash dash help. Let's make this window a bit larger. Just a command runner. So change log choose. So the example does not work. That's not exactly inspiring. Just serve Game Boy. Cargo, or rather, Rust, just no just file found. Let's see, just a command runner, right? So what exactly does this even do? Just as a handy way to save and run project-specific commands. Command called recipes are stored in a file called justfile with syntax inspired by make. So why is no justfile provided in here? Is it at like some super directory? Oh right, yeah, the justfile is here. So I guess we have to copy that and create a new file. Nope, that's wrong. Just file, it has no file ending, right? Right, it's just a just file. Now we should find it. Cannot stat gameboy/index.html. Oh, we actually need HTML as well, I guess. I guess it may. Obviously, we need. Nope. We want the minimal web example. Right, we just need some basic. Right. Super minimal. So just edit the index.html and this should not be minimal web, this should be Game Boy. And it still does not find the that just file is just wrong. package/index.html, nope. We just want index.html. And I think that should be it. It's compiling, or it's rather it's downloading something. crates. I hope it doesn't like compile for half an hour again, because that would be kind of a boring stream. Oh no, it's fast. I guess most of these were already included in the mini-surf crate we downloaded earlier, so it can just reuse that. 63, 64. I wonder if this will work. I hope it does. I've got some Game Boy technical sheets open here. These are just the CPU instructions supported by the Game Boy. I guess I should also just quickly check. No, the ROM. I've got ROM downloaded already because that's legally kind of a gray zone, so I didn't want to do it on stream. So I've got ROMs downloaded. I can quickly show you. Why are the PDFs in there? I didn't mean to save them in there. I should just remove them. Style.zip. Right, ROMs. Weird. ROMs/star.zip. It's not a zip file, it's a PDF file. Right. So I've got that one ROM file here for the Game Boy Color, because that's the exact Game Boy I want to emulate. I guess I could write a README for now while we are compiling over there. Game Boy. This is a Game Boy Color emulator written in Rust. It uses the pixel crate for graphics and runs in the browser using the magic of WebAssembly. I guess I should link to the pixel crate. Pixel actually just released version 0.8. Can't type today. All right. Unknown release, Game Boy wasn't bind gen not found. Wasm-bindgen, is that like a command? Let's look in the just file. Cargo let's just Google for that. I don't know, I just want this to work. Rust wasm-bindgen. I think I used this before. A bit surprised it's not installed already. Why are there no installation instructions? Why? How do I install this API docs? Can I just do cargo install Wasm bindgen, because it has no binaries. Yes, that's a library, obviously. I don't know. This is taking quite a while to set up. Examples, troubleshooting, cargo resolver. Rust lock trace. So I guess wasm bindgen is what actually transforms the compiled. Right, cargo build compiles the source code to the WebAssembly target. And where's a bind gen, then con transforms that, whatever that is, into the actual WASM file. So why is it not installed? WASM bindgen CLI tool. Command line interface. The WASM bindgen guide. Cargo inst. Oh. Dash CLI, I guess. Programming in Rust is kind of a pain because you just have to compile so much. I guess the good part is that we only have to compile this once. But it is kind of annoying, like starting a project and just sitting in front of the compiler for half an hour straight. And I can't really read up on like how the memory in the Game Boy works, which I still have to do, by the way. I don't know this stuff. I can't read up on that because I don't know what problems I'm going to run into. I guess this is just a bit flag, so I think there was a crate in Rust for that, which did it in a pretty nice way. Rust bit flag. I remember using a crate for that like half a year ago, and I think it was pretty nice. Right, that one. That one. Right, right, right. Right, because you can just combine different values using OR and it's just super clean. I like this crate a lot. I don't like the compiler a lot. Let's look at the Game Boy Color. Because that's what we're emulating. The Game Boy Color. Sold over 100 million times. Nice. So input wise, this is really super simple. It's just got the four arrow keys, the B and A key, and the select and start buttons. So just 8 keys in total. Should be super simple to handle the input. Though I remember seeing somewhere in here that the input was done in a weird way. Maybe it wasn't this PDF. I can't find it anymore, but there was some weird stuff where inputs would mean different things depending on some other bits, like if that bit was high. If some bit was high, it would be that key, and if some other bit was low, then it would be that key. So some really weird mapping, which probably was super efficient, but it's just weird to emulate. Can you finish compiling already? 134 out of 161. Nice. 141. By the way, this is not like some chip8 emulator or whatever. There are actually really cool games for the Game Boy Color. And I do actually want to use it. I just searched for Game Boy Color twice. In Game Boy Color games, there's like some Pokemon games, some of the really old ones, or rather the original ones. Tetris, the original Tetris runs on that system. Really cool stuff. ...915 games in total. Compare that to something like a PS4 today, where there are like 2 quadrillion games, because they're not official. Nope, we don't wanna donate to Wikipedia on stream. 007 games, actually. See, this is the kind of stuff that I would just really like to play, because this game is older than me. I really want to see what it's like. The weird or the stupid stuff is just like you can't legally download these games because obviously they are copyrighted, but you can't buy them either. Because they're not being sold anymore, obviously, because the platform they run on has been dead for like a decade. More than a decade. So there's just no real way to legally obtain these games. Which, I guess it isn't really a problem if you do want to download them illegally, but it kind of sucks because, like, I would actually pay for that. Maybe not for this game, like, but for some of the old Pokemon games, some of the really cool ones. Sure, I'd pay for that, but I can't. Because they are not being sold anymore. Bob the Builder, fix it fun. Gotta love these old games. From 2000. That's over 20 years ago. So cool. And we are almost done compiling. Almost. Last crate. Right, finally. So now we can do just serve Game Boy and it should run now, finally, please. This took 7 minutes to compile. Like, that's insane. Available at localhost 8080. Localhost port 8080. And we see, I think that's what we're supposed to see. Cool. So it's like these retro screensavers. These DVD screensavers. Cool. I guess that works. Now let's try. Favicon.ico could not be found. That stuff I'm gonna worry about later. We don't need a favicon for now. I actually wanna get coding. Is there like a live? Can I just do live reload with miniserve? Serve dash dash help. Archive generation, show instead of host, page title, index, hidden, I would really like autosurf. I guess we don't need it for now, but I do want to have it later. Now 160 by 144, that does not look like 160 by 144. Now, how is this supposed to work? How is memory actually stored in the Game Boy? See, this is the kind of stuff that I can't look up earlier because I don't know about it. Video. We have 160 by 144 pixels. We have two backgrounds, the main background and the window background. 10 objects, maximum 10 per line, we don't care about that. 8 by 8 pixel tiles. 456 cycles per line, 70,224 cycles per frame, DMG mode, CBG mode. So I guess we want to go with CBG mode, because we're emulating the Game Boy Color. So what is the Game Boy VRAM? I think that's where the buffer is stored. Game Boy Dev Wiki. Oh, this looks like it's good. I guess we should start by actually implementing the memory. So we have hex FFF F bytes of memory. That's 65 kilobytes. And our Game Boy should no longer be a box. It should have memory. Memory which will be use U8 because it's bytes. Const memory equals 256 times 256, and this should be a use size, and maybe name it memory size so we actually know what it stands for. Okay, and then there are these separators. Everything until hex 7 FFF is the ROM region. ROM region. Now, what? Actually, let's keep that. What is 7FFF in decimals? ?32,000. Makes sense, I guess. So we want to have everything until 32,000 be the ROM region. And then up to the VRAM, it should be up to 9FFF, it should be the VRAM. Now this should be 9, and that's 40,000, so 8 kilobytes on top of that. VRAM, U-size equals... Then the next one is the RAM region. This is also a use size. And it's up to BFFF. So another 8 kilobytes on top of the VRAM. The next one is WRAM. I don't know what that is, but Let's just roll with it. It's another U size, and it's up to DFFF. DFFF, 57 kilobytes. And then we've got the echo, which I think that's just like a bit-by-bit copy of the WRAM. I don't know why it exists, but apparently it does. Maybe no one. I think even the people who reverse engineered the Game Boy don't really know why it's there. And it's from E0 to FDFFF. I guess we should actually add one. I guess we should always add one byte in here. 8, 960, 52, and 44. So we actually end up with an exclusive range, because that's easier to deal with later. Then we have the OAM up to FE9F. No, we first have to add the echo. That's up to FE00. Const echo. FE00 FE00 65 kilobytes. Right, we are almost at the end of our memory. There we go. Then we've got the OAM memory. OAM, which is also a U size. Memory mapped IO. I guess we are going to... Did I just... Right, that's wrong. That's wrong. Is it? Is it wrong? I'm not sure. Can I just like define these stupid numbers in hex? Rust const hex. Numbers, like, this is stupid. I don't want to convert them all. Hex literal data, which is that? No. I just want Rust use hex numbers at compile time. Memory safe, what a byte. Rust for embedded C programmers. I want none of this. So the OAM goes up to FF00. No, right, there's two OAM regions. And the invalid OAM goes up to FF00. Which is 65 to 80. Const E OAM, which is the U size, name that, behavior varies depending on the revision. Then we've got the HiRAM. No, we've got the memory mapped IO, which is up to FF80. Const mem IO users. And the last, no, not the last one, that's HRAM, which goes up to FFFF. Right. And then we maybe shouldn't like... I guess we can give it two names, because the memory size is also the IE register. Cool. Now, what do we do now? How is the buffer actually drawn to the frame? There's a lot more memory stuff here, which I don't really care about for now. Video display, LCD control register. Game Boy VRAM guide. There's gotta be, like, the Game Boy has been emulated a lot of times. It's like a classic. A document about the down and dirty timing of the Game Boy's video hardware. So that's like the BIOS and stuff, that's fixed. So we actually want to start our ROM. Wait, no. Game ROMs go here, predefined ROM, let's just call them ROM1 and ROM2 for now. frame buffer, the RAM region. That's pretty obvious what that is. Copy of WRAM. MIO. IO stuff. Right. Cartridge header in the first ROM bank. The memory at 0100 contains the cartridge header. This area contains information about the CRO program, its entry point, checksums, information about the used MBC chips, the ROM and RAM sizes, etc. Most of the bytes in this area are required to be specified correctly. External memory and hardware. The areas from 0 and 8 may be used to connect external hardware. The first area is typically used to address ROMs, read-only of course, write, read-only memory, cartridges with memory bank controllers, additionally using this area to output data write-only to the MBC chip. Right, this is the echo RAM. I want to learn about that. The memory range is a mirror or echo of WRAM, both for reading and for writing. For example, writing to NIP. It is recommended to avoid using this memory range anyways. Has been confirmed on all gray as well as on all color Game Boys. Some emulators don't emulate EchoRAM. It's possible to check if EchoRAM is probably emulated by writing to WRAM and checking if set value is, of course. So we don't need to actually emulate the no one knows why it's here. No need to actually emulate it. The interrupts enable register. I should maybe note that down. Interrupts enable register. But sprite attribute table OAM. Game Boy Video Controller can display up to 40 sprites in either 8x8 or 8x16 pixels. Because of a limitation of the hardware, only 10 sprites can be displayed per scan line. Sprite patterns have the same format as BG tiles. What are BG tiles? Located at 8 to 8 FFF and have unsigned numbering. Accessing VRAM at OAM. When the LCD controller is drawn on the screen, it is directly reading from video memory and from the sprite attribute table. During these periods, the Game Boy CPU may not access the VRAM at OAM. This means that any attempts to VRAM OAM are ignored, the data remains unchanged, and any attempts will return undefined data. Right, that's a problem in the real world, Game Boy is real, but like in real world as well, which is why we use dual buffering. And any attempts to read from VRAM OAM will return undefined data. For this reason, the program should verify if VRAM is accessible before actually reading or writing to it. But I still don't understand how anything is drawn. Tile data is stored. This area. from 8,000 to... Okay. In CBG mode because of the two VRAM banks. I think I actually have to add another VRAM bank, but I can do that later. Each tile is sized 8x8 pixels and has a color depth of 4 colors or gray shades. Right, a more visual explanation, please. Two bits per pixel. As the name 2BPP implies, it takes exactly 2 bits to store the information about a single pixel. Actually, maybe let's not emulate the Game Boy Color, because the way I see it right now, the Game Boy, the original Game Boy, is way, way easier to emulate because of stuff like that. And it's also way more known how it actually works. This is an example of a single tile. It's a window from a house. Right. So, 2 bits per pixel. So, each of these, each, each letter represents 2 pixels. So, 2 letters represent 4 pixels. Meaning that there should be 16 bytes here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Right. As a result, any uncompressed graphics data present in a Game Boy ROM file is represented using exactly 16 bytes. I should have just read the text. Each consecutive pair of bytes represents a single row in the 8x8 tile. Right, so that is the first row, that's the second one, that's the third one. To determine the color of a single pixel, we need to combine those 2 bytes in a specific way. The first byte is the low byte. And the second byte is the high byte to determine the pixel of the first row. The first pixel of the first row. We look at the most significant bit of both bytes and combine those 2 bits by treating the bit coming from the high byte as the most significant bit. FF, you're right. 0 is the high byte. Where the second one is the high byte. Oof. Low byte. Dip, 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 dip. So we combine the results. Why did they do it like that? That's like super counterintuitive. Why not just make this one the high byte and that one the low byte? So I really need to operate on the bits themselves. So I guess let's do a function decode sprite. Let's do that below the constants. And as an argument, it takes 16 bytes. U8, 16. And it should return, what should it return? Mm-hmm. Let's just do U8 64. I don't think we actually need to worry about memory, because like that's obviously a huge waste, because we are storing a value from 0 to 4 in a U8, which can be from 0 to 256, so we are just wasting 6 of the 8 bits. But honestly, on any modern computer, I don't think we need to care about that at all. So now, this one decode sprites. We want to go in pairs of 2. Let's address. Zero 64. Let's just initialize everything with 0. And for pair index in 0.8. We want to slice the bytes. Byte 1. Would be byte 1 index would be 2 times the pair index, and byte 2 index would be 2 times the pair index plus 1. Great. So let's byte 1 would be bytes of that, and byte 2, actually let's just name them the high byte and the low byte already, just to avoid confusion later on. And now we need their binary representation, and I don't know how to get it. Rust U8 as binary. There's got to be some function about like getting the nth bit. No, not really. U8 1. Nice. it converts 1 byte into 1 byte. Is power of 2 leading 1s, leading 0s. Reverse bits. Like I can think of multiple ways to do this, but I want to do it in a clean way, and that's kind of hard. Rust get nth bit of byte. But it should have applications elsewhere as well. Maybe something with the No, not next power of 2. Is power of 2 from bytes count zeros count 1? Nope, nope, nope. Well, let's just make our own function fn nth bits, which will take an eval, which is a u8, and return the bool. And obviously also n, which must also be a u size. Now, we want to probably bit or eval with, if it's the 0th bit, the 0th bit is the first bit, so we want to go 2 dot pow I 8 minus n. And we want to see if that value does not equal 0. I really don't trust this implementation. I really don't. I guess, can we somehow test it, like with a window in here? No easy way to do it. If nth bit of, right, which bit do we actually want? Because 2 bytes contain 8. For bit in dot 8, nth bit of the high byte, bit, actually let's name this n. If nth bit of the low byte of n, so if we've got 0, 1, then we want to write the results, namely we want to have the pair index times 8 plus n. And that should equal 0 and 1, so that would be 1. And then we want to have the same in here, but this time it's 0, 0, so that would be 0. And we want to basically copy that code over. So if it's 1, 1, that would be 4. No, it would be 3. And this one, which is 1, 0, would be 2. Now we want to just return that sprite. Right. So that's done. I don't feel like that was a clean implementation at all. Right. Of 2BPP in this informational document about the Game Boy. The diagram, the 16 bytes are. digits represent color numbers. I guess the dot is a zero. Dot dot 3 3. So we basically get a tile like that. I guess I should also link all of the articles because I've got a lot of them open. I'm kind of scared of losing my sources. Sources. Game Boy Sprite Format. And it's no longer a Game Boy Color emulator. Maybe this guy has some other stuff. I'm starting a blog. Carrot Crazy. Right, so he's reverse engineering Game Boy stuff. Right, but nothing of interest to us. Game Boy VRAM draw cycle, maybe? Anything? Game Boy Advance Architecture, practical analysis. A quick introduction. Before you begin, you find between the SNES and Game Boy. I think this might be what we're looking for. All graphics calculations are done by the CPU, then the picture processing unit, or the PPU, renders them. This is another component found inside the DMG CPU, and it's actually based on the predecessor's PPU. An integrated LCD screen, it has a resolution of... and it shows four shades of gray. It follows CRT. Wait, did the original Game Boys have a CRT beam? I just want to know. Wow. That's dangerous. The PPU has 8 kilobytes of VRAM, which both PPU and CPU can access directly but not at the same time. Those 8 kilobytes will contain most of the data the PPU will need to render the graphics. The remaining bits will be stored inside the PPU instead, as they require a faster access rate. So the PPU is kind of the OAM, that's where... So the sprites are stored in the VRAM, and some other stuff is stored in the OAM. But this is exactly what I wanted. Definitely want to link that in my README. More, or rather, how the VRAM is structured. The PPU uses tiles. Super Mario Land 2. Okay. The PPU uses tiles as a basic ingredient for rendering graphics, specifically sprites and backgrounds. Tiles are just 8x8 bitmaps stored in the VRAM. Right, that's what we just did. Each pixel corresponds to one of the four shades of gray available. Finally, tiles are grouped into two pattern tables. In order to build the picture, tiles are referenced in another type of table called the tile map. How tile maps are used to construct the layers. So each of these blocks would be a tile in a region called the tile set. Right, but where exactly is that tile set? Is that in the ROM? Because I guess it would be in the ROM because it's game data, right? So it should be in the ROM. The background is a 256 map containing static tiles. However, remember that only 160 by 144. That's what I meant earlier. Not all of the background is actually so shown. Games can also move the viewable area. Oh, right, cool. So that's how they do that scroll effect. The window is a 100 displayed on top of the background and sprites. It does not scroll. The remaining tile map can be assigned to the windows layer. At first, this may sound like a silly feature. After all, the window layer overlaps everything else. So it's just UI stuff like the score or the health. Right, cool. Sprites are tiles that move independently around the screen. They can also overlap each other and appear behind the background. The viewable graphic will be decided based on a priority attribute. They also have an extra color available, so they can only display four. Right, so the sprites are even more limited. Luckily, this layer allows defining two color bands. Wait, what? The map stored inside the PPU, which defines the tiles that will be used as sprites. Oh! By calling the DMA unit found inside the chip, the DMA fetches the data from the ROM. Oh, right, so the OAM contains the sprites which move around the screen. That's actually really interesting. Part of the PPU contains sprites, movable tiles. Up to 10 sprites per scale line and up to 40 per frame. Overflowing this will result in the sprites not being drawn. Horizontal blank interrupt is called. This is such a good page. Like, this is exactly what I wanted. Exactly. Like, just down to the detail. This is exactly what you need to emulate this kind of stuff. The inclusion of the window layer and extra inputs allowed for new types of contents and effects. A wobble effect. Audio. What did PPU stand for again? PPU was the picture processing unit. Who would have thought? And the APU is kind of similar. I think audio is something we can maybe do later. Wait, the cartridges? That's so interesting. I actually wondered how cartridges can save the game state, because it's not stored on the actual Game Boy, it's stored on the cartridge. And it has, because like, if you store data in RAM and then you disconnect it from the power, that RAM will just die. I mean, it won't die, but it will discharge and lose the entire data. So the cartridges actually have an external battery. Meaning that if you find like a cartridge from 20 years ago, and the battery died, your saves are gone. That's really cool though. External communications. No, Game Boy Link cable, we are not going to do this. To be able to pass these checks. I mean, how could anyone pass this? You have to include a copy of Nintendo's logo in the form of the tiles in its ROM header. Oh, so I guess it was, they couldn't make it illegal to just create games for the Game Boy, so they decided that the Game Boy will only run games that include Nintendo's logo in it, and you're not allowed to use that logo unless you're like an official partner due to the copyright and trademarks law. That's a really creative way. This is such a good page. So we start reading at the first address, which is the Game Boy ROM. Information. Oh, it even cites its sources. This is the most amazing I've ever seen. Diagram, blah blah blah. We don't care about that. So, I guess now I might. Work RAM, no, this is 4 times larger than what the NES included. So VRAM, WRAM actually stands for work RAM. Could note that. Work RAM. Now, I think now I just want to load the. Maybe move the Game Boy to an external file, because like this is mostly just WebAssembly stuff. Gameboy.rs. Let's make that struct public. State of the game at a certain. Contains the entire memory. And now we can do impulse on that. We have a public function load ROM, which maybe takes a path buffer or whatever. What should it take, actually? I gotta look up the file IO stuff again. Rust's file IO stuff is super convoluted file IO. Open. Create that file. File.read to string. Let's see if we can also read to a byte array. File setlens or permissions. Where's that read to string function? Read. Returning how many bytes were read. Read to end, placing them into a buffer. That is exactly what we want. Read exact. Yes, yes, this is so good. So we want to use read exact. If this was a larger file, you would probably want to use a buff reader to not like open the entire file in memory. But since the ROMs are like sub, can I please copy this text? Use stdfs file. Is going on. I'm super confused. Use stdfs file. Use stdio read. I think read is actually the only trait we actually need. And maybe use std path path. Okay, so the path. Use anyhow result. We want to use anyhow because it's just a clean library for error handling. We want to take a path which is str, and we want to return a result. Actually, we don't want to return anything, we just want to return a result. And also, of course, a mutable reference to the Game Boy itself, so we can write to the memory. Path equals path new, and that will take the path. Maybe path str, so we know it's in string format. Display equals path.display. Why would we? IO result file. This API is so weird. I feel like I always did it in another way, right? File open. We want to open the path, and then we want to file.read exact, and you want to read from self.memory. All these constants should also be in the Game Boy file. Okay, and then we want to use create Game Boy to actually import it in the main function. And I think we also have to use mod Game Boy to tell Rust that there's a Game Boy file in that directory. Actually, I probably want to move these functions as well. Okay. Now, what arguments does readexec take again? It takes just the buffer. Oh, nice. So I don't actually need to tell it how much. Now, how large was the ROM again? From ROM 1 to ROM 2, I think it was. Right. ROM 1 to ROM 2. And if that fails, we want to just return. And if it doesn't fail, we want to return OK. Load a game ROM from a provided path. OK. Actually, maybe I just want to get rid of that entire WebAssembly stuff for now, because it's going to take a while before we are actually going to draw anything to the screen. And for now it's just annoying because I can't debug anything. Yeah, I probably want to do that. Just comment out everything. Use Game Boy, nope. Create Game Boy, and then we want to have the function main. Then we obviously also want to have a constructor for the Game Boy, which takes no arguments and returns self. That should just be a Game Boy where the memory is just 0 for memory size. Right. Why was that struct defined? Right, U8. Cool. Let GB equal Game Boy GB. That should be of course mutable. GB.load ROM, was that what it's called? Right, load ROM from roms/rom1.gbc. And we want to also return an anyhow result in here. Because that's just nicer. Cool. And we're back to compiling. Okay. The SM83 keeps an 8-bit data bus and a 16-bit address bus, so up to 64 kilobytes of memory can be addressed. The memory map composed of cartridge space, WRAM and display RAM, IO and interrupt controls. Okay. Game Boy BIOS, because I still need to get that like proprietary ROM for the Game Boy, where it checks, for example, whether the cartridge is valid. Game Boy boot ROM. Nintendo Game Boy boot ROM. That's 469 bytes and no comments. Oh, I don't trust this. But I have to. Actually, let's just hide the stream for a bit, because I do not know if what I am doing is legal. I mean, I'm of course not downloading it, I'm just using another source. I would never do anything illegal. The ROM I have is actually for the Game Boy Color. Gotta get another one as well. Don't worry, I'll be back soon. Stern.gbc, because I don't need any old ROMs. BIOS.gb. Okay, so I've got the BIOS. Let's get this one. So now I've got all my ROMs. I mean, I already had them before, of course. And we're back. I can show you, I now in my ROMs directory. Alice. I now have the BIOS, which I can just load into memory as soon as possible. And I've got some syntax errors, of course. 31. That should be a semicolon. And this one should not be rom1.gbc. Actually, maybe this should also to the provided memory address, because that way we have multiple from which is a u size to which is also a u size, because that way we can also load the BIOS using the load ROM function from to two. Let mut g equals, and then we want to load the ROM. G dot load ROM from ROM slash BIOS dot gb, and we want to load it from 0 to the ROM 1. And if that fails, I guess Game Boy itself should fail. Okay, now I gotta adjust this one here. We wanna import all these constants, and we wanna load it from ROM 1 to ROM 2. No Game Boy in Game Boy. I think that should work now. Probably still some syntax errors to figure out, but should work. If it would actually start to compile it anytime soon. Actually, I should maybe adjust the stream title, because we are not coding a Game Boy Color emulator anymore. We are just coding a Game Boy emulator, undeclared type. Oh, I actually had two syntax errors on the same line. I wonder why I always put a comma in there. It's always the same. Slash Game Boy address, and we want to immutably borrow from here. Atmut Game Boy dot address, and we want to return OKG because it worked. And there are still some undefined tokens. Let's just get rid of that sprite function we did earlier, because honestly it's just such a stupid implementation. And I also really don't need it for now, because like I said, I won't be doing any drawing for a while. And so it's just messing things up right now. Oh, so I need to make the constants public. Slash const slash pub const slash. Okay, and for X, remove that. Now it should all be public, but the load ROM function is still not found because we are not unwrapping the result. Cool. Error failed to fill whole buffer. So, because the actual BIOS is too small for the buffer, it can't load the entire thing. Why is that an error? Just fill it with zeros, I don't care. STDFS file rust. Oh, I guess it's the what's the read trait? There's got to be like a try read or try whatever function. Oh, other items, right. I just want the read trait. I guess I can go through the file. Read. Right. So read is vectored. Read all bytes until end of file in the source, placing them into the buffer. So why can I not use read to end? Why can I not use read to end in there? Right, because it expects a vector. But why does it want a vector for that? Oh, this is so annoying. I should also really stop streaming because I've got other stuff to do this evening. So yeah, I might fix this another time. Like, this stream was basically just figuring stuff out and learning how the Game Boy works, how it draws from its memory, how the memory is structured. So we didn't actually do that much coding. But honestly, I think that's fine. Yep. I'm gonna end the stream now.